besides the house rule of putting your cell phone on silence mode, the second house rule is we start on time. So 1:40 is 1:40. Please, you have the whole Monday morning to recover from your weekend. Try to be in time. It's the same, by the way, for the Thursday when we have our tutoring. What's on the menu for today? First, I'll give you an overview of the course on incident response. Then, I'll take you through some fundamentals that we need when we are talking about incident response. There will be quite a lot of topics that will be familiar to the security students. So that's nice for them. And it will be most of the time probably new for the FIS students. Then we are going to talk about the assignments you are going to do. And last but not least, the homework, what to read, what to study, and what to do with the assignment and when to deliver the results. Thank you, Dominika. Overview of the course. Well, I didn't mention my name yet. I only said security students and forensic intelligence and security students, or shortly it will be SEC student and FIS students. My name is Carla Bombelt. I'm a lecturer researcher on electronic discovery, and by the way, I will do some lecturing during the thematical semester on security. I do the course on risk assessment and the course on incident response, and well, way in the future, when we talk about digital forensic investigations as a new semester, I'll do, besides the projects, a course on incident investigation. And for those students who don't know yet what to choose in the next year, I will pinpoint the possibility that you, as a full-time student, can attend the part-time minor electronic discovery that's taking place with lectures on Thursday evening, 8:30, no, 6:30 till 10 o'clock p.m. And the enlisting for this for the minors are open now. I think this is the last week for you as students if you want to enlist yourself either for security or if you want to the part-time minor electronic discovery. Full-timers are more than welcome. It's not only meant for part-time students. Only the program is going to be according to the lecture times of the part-time program. Okay, what do I do? Well, besides lecturing in all kind of states and places and programs, I do a lecture on intelligence data analysis for aviation. I always have several students that I accompany in doing their final thesis, mostly part-time students. And my background, I thought about it yesterday and I discovered that it's almost 30 years ago, that's a life, your more than your lifetime, that I started in IT. First as a junior programmer, then a programmer, systems analyst, then a system designer, project manager, whatever. From very big systems, the mainframes, through mid-range systems to PC. So I have a lot of working experience in IT. I also have a lot of working experience in education, in teaching, and I know a lot. And I want to share it with you. Because I like it when people want to know more, are interested about the topic, and then I'll do my best to give you some clues and hints where to find things, how to see things, and I hope I'll can manage that during the course on incident response. What are the learning objectives of this course? I'll step back on some key concepts and the fundamentals of security, information security. I want you at the end of this course to know what incident response is, which duties you have to perform and which responsibilities you have when we talk about incident response. I want you to learn about the incident response model and not only learn but also apply it hands-on. And the hands-on will be mainly, well, stumbling through how to handle a specific incident. On the contrary, when we look at the first course, risk assessment, that was theory and applying the theory on a practical situation. For incident response, I do it the reverse way. We do a practical assignment and then afterwards we are going to look into, well, what concepts and theory is behind the results that you had produced for an assignment. So it's a learning by doing. Structure of the course. Well, I just told you we are going to look deep into the field of security with the accent on information security. And when we talk about security, you always have something that goes wrong. Shit happens. And that is what we call an incident, a security incident. How can you handle it? Then we have to know something about three main concepts. Detection, how to detect an incident, how to react on an incident, and if the incident is over, to evaluate what happened so that we can learn a lesson from that incident and that we can try to prevent the same kind of accident from happening again. Then you have to know how can we perform a really good incident response. And because we work with a lot of data, you learn also how to structure and to visualize lots of data. And how are we going to do that? Well, for the security students, it's a piece of cake. Monday, the lecture. Thursday, the tutoring sessions. Besides the lecture on Monday and the tutoring on Thursday, you have several practical assignments to do. And at the end, you have to take the final exam. Then you want to know, of course, the schedule. Well, I made you a timetable. You see quarter period four. On the left-hand side, the moments we have our lectures. And on the right-hand side of the table, you see the tutoring sessions. So you can start planning in your agenda or maybe in your cell phone when you have to be where at what time. Today, Monday the 13th of April, is our first lecture. Next Monday, our second one. And the third one is a holiday in the Netherlands, so there is will be no lecture on Monday. Then we have our holiday week in May, Building closed. So no lectures, no tutoring. Then our third and fourth lecture will be somewhere in May. And then you see on the 25th of May, no lecture. Again, a holiday. And our final lecture will be on the 1st of June. On the other hand, the tutoring is scheduled always on Thursday, starting 1:40. The tutoring will be for the security students different from when you compare it to the former quarter, the former period. We have, because we have so many groups, 105 students, I'm going to do it different. You have the whole Thursday afternoon, starting from 1:40 till 5 o'clock, for working on the practical assignment of that week. During the tutoring session, we'll have a specific appointment at a specific time in a specific room where I want one member of each team, I'll come back on teams and so on and so on, joining that meeting as a liaison officer, and then we are going to discuss what questions are there in the teams and what do you need on extra information to continue working on the assignment. So you don't have per class a separate tutoring hour. You work all afternoon in your team on the assignment. Except on the Thursday after our May holiday, you see on the 14th of May, we have an obligatory holiday. And also the Friday after this Thursday. So no tutoring at all. You see there's a lot of blue because the fourth period is always the period with a lot of holidays. So this is the timetable for incident response. What are you going to do? Well, we have a book, our mandatory book, Computer Security Principles and Practice by William Stallings and Laurie Brown. The FIS and the SEC students should have this book because you used it in period 3 for infrastructure security. And you should need it for software security and incident response as security students, and you need it for incident response being a FIS student. I noted down the chapters that are the most important in relationship to this course. The chapters at the third line are paragraphs. So they come up when it's necessary. As you know, we have a relationship between what's in the book and what's the according CISSP domain. Yes, Erik?
At the second line of the chapters we need to learn, I see 16 and 17.
Yes?
15 and 16, sorry. And at the third line I see again 15.5 and 16.6.
Yes?
Does that mean we don't have to learn the rest of 16 and 15, or?
You have to study 15 and 16 all the way, and special attention to 55 and 16.4 and 16.6. When this chapter is due, is on the schedule, I will give some hints how to deal with chapter 15 and chapter 16. Is that enough for an answer at this moment? Okay. So we have three domains that correlate with the chapters and say something about incident response, that's domain number 7, operation security. Your ongoing daily business is happening. Poof! Then an incident comes up. Then you have to know what to do while continuing operation security to handle such an incident. Sometimes the incident is this kind of big that it's a catastrophe. And then you have to take advantage of domain 8, your business continuity and disaster recovery planning. So if we have an incident in the form of a major disaster, you have to prevent your business and your daily operations from shutting down and from totally disrupting your company so that your company could go broke or disappear. And of course, domain 9, legal regulations, investigations and compliance, it's most of the time a little boring chapter and a little boring domain, but I'll want to pick out only those items out of the domain number 9. And the according chapter by head is chapter 19, I think. We'll go into the stuff we need for investigations. For those who want to know more, I set up per domain of the CISSP the according chapters. It's not necessary now, but you have it and you can use it when you are preparing yourself for the final exam. Okay, with what are you going to do all this? Two things. Practice component, that makes up 60% of your final grade, and your theoretical component, which makes up 40% of your final grade. Theory is individual. You do on your own the final exam, as usual. The practice, the assignments, will be done in teams. For the theory, well, you have your book, you have the lecture slides, and sometimes I'll deliver some extra material that is going to be studied, and everything will be delivered in the virtual learning environment, the VLO. Practice. Of course, you get a practical assignment. Sometimes I'll hand out some extra resources, and sometimes, or most of the times, you have to look for additional material and you have to search and find it for yourself as a team. And it's a good start when you go to the Wikipedia page, the English one, for some background information, get some hints on extra literature, whatever. By the way, although it's 60-40, both components, so your exam and the total of your practical assignments, should be at least a 6. Now, on specific Mondays, see timetable or schedule, we have the time from 1:40 until 5 o'clock, and then we are going to talk about incident response topics. Not today, but from the next lecture. We are going to discuss the finished practical assignment that will start next Monday. And you get a briefing on a new practical assignment. Today, I'll give some fundamentals where we're going to build on talking about incident response, and you get your first briefing on your first practical assignment. Then, like I told you on Thursday, from 1:40 until 5 o'clock, you have time in your team to work on and put questions forward about the practical assignment. Homework is always finishing the last lecture, preparing the next lecture, and of course, that's individual. And next to that, you work on your assignment as a team. How you schedule that, that is for the team to figure out. The exam, it's about the book, Computer Security, only the incident response chapters I just mentioned. You can prepare yourself through the self-assessment questions from Stallings per chapter, of course the lecture slides and the official additional material I upload into the VLO. You get an individual exam, multiple choice questions, 60 minutes for answering, and there's only one answer correct. And probably it will be in the examination week, so week 10, when you look at the year schedule. And I want to arrange it again like the last examination period, that you have your exam time during class hours, like you are used to, that you are either on Monday or Tuesday or Thursday you are at school. So I try to arrange again that you have on one of these days your exam scheduled. Okay, questions so far?
The minor students only got 50 minutes every first day for the practical work. So is it mandatory to do it in teams? Because around our other project work and other teamwork, it's a little bit hard to schedule to do your assignments in teams.
Well, because you are two classes, you have 1 hour for one class and another hour for another class. So, you have your projects for FIS, they should be scheduled on Friday. You have the possibility to join guest lectures that are scheduled on Wednesday. And then you have your other FIS lectures. And I think Adrie has scheduled them on Monday or Tuesday, whatever.
On Thursday and Wednesday.
Okay.
But is it possible to do them individual, or you really have to do them in teams?
You have to do it in teams. So you have to arrange with your team when are you available to do the part that you took on your shoulders. So that is, you have to do some communication and interaction when you, at the end of, or during this afternoon, we'll have the teams and then you will make arrangements within your team.
How many members does a team consist of?
Just wait a minute, we'll talk about the teams later on. Any other questions on the stuff so far? No? Then I'll take you through the first part of the overview about the fundamentals. Security.
When is the pairing?
I can't hear you.
When is the pairing of the teams?
The team building, the team forming will be coming up soon. Okay. This afternoon, you know in which team you are. Don't worry. I'm not going to answer that. Just wait and see. Okay, security. It's important to look into the difference between the one S and the other S, safety and security. Safety is the condition of being safe, so there is no danger, there's no risk, and there is no possibility of injury. So safety is more or less human related. Then we have security, that embodies all the measures you take to deliver a condition that you are protected. You protect your organization and the people that work in the organization against hazards, threats, risks, or loss. So when you think about security, you always have to bear in mind that safety is first. People are your most valuable asset, and you have to take care that your people and yourself, being human, are not in danger or at risk or being injured. And then we are going to look into security. Because the name of the semester is security, the focus will be on security, but always remember safety first. Security is short, protection of assets. Assets is the word that has to stick into your mind. Protection of assets. One of the assets that every organization has is information. And when you talk about security, you talk about all assets. And when you talk about information security, you talk only about one of the four assets, namely information. And we have to take into account the characteristics of information like you see them. The famous CIA, not the Central Intelligence Agency, but the C of confidentiality, integrity, availability. Those three characteristics, also called the CIA triad, are at the bottom, but next to those three you have to take care about the accuracy, the authenticity, the utility, and the possession of information. So, if you talk about security, it's about protection of assets. Information security is about protection of information as only one of the four assets. And the main reason you want to take care of information security is that you want to ensure that your business can be alive, can stay alive. So business continuity is essential. We want not only to assure our business to continue, but we also want to ensure that we have as less as business risk as possible. Zero risk, keep dreaming. You always have a certain amount of risk, but you want to minimize it depending on how much money you are able or willing to invest in measures to counter risks. And you have to balance between what will it cost you financially and what will it give you in gain when we talk about information security measures. And I didn't invent this definition. It's from the ISO IEC 27002 from 2007. That's a very important mode or norm or model that you can use when you talk about information security. You'll have to need to study the 27002/2007 during the upcoming weeks. But I will give you a hint when to start and where to look and where to find, because it's a big one. Remember when we talk about information and we all IT people amongst each other that there is more than digital information. Don't forget about the old-fashioned analog information, the paper documents. So we are not only talking about electronically stored information, shortly ESI. We are also talking about paper documents. Remember also that when we look at information, it comes to us in four states. It can be in use, like this PowerPoint is now in use. It can be in motion. When I upload this PowerPoint presentation into the VLO, then it's in motion. This PowerPoint presentation can also is also on my USB drive, so it's at rest. And it's not out of use yet, because we just started period four. So remember that the life cycle of a piece of information is either in use or in motion or at rest or out of use. And sometimes it's not or, but it's all together. So we always have to remember when we are dealing with an incident, what information as an asset is involved? Is it analog and or digital? And is it in use or in motion or at rest? Or out of use in our archives? Where do you find information security? Well, if you look at your information as an asset, our digital ones and zeros, then we have all the IT infrastructure below, and we have all the business services upwards. And through all these layers, information is streaming. How do we get our security ready? Well, we need a lot of means. You can see it's like an umbrella with a lot of shit underneath. We talked about, where is it? We talked about physical security last quarter, about awareness, about policies, about standards, a bit about compliance. We are now mainly talking about incident response, but we can't talk alone on incident response. We have to be aware about auditing, about compliance, about physical security. How about our applications? Do we need policy standards? Is there a violation? Is there permission to do something or to do something not? How about gaining or getting access to something? How about countermeasures like antivirus and IDS or IPS systems? We need to be aware of our daily operations, and then oops, something happens, then we have to switch from operations control to incident response. We have to be aware what can happen, and if oops, something happens, we have to decide if we have a disaster at hand, and then we have to recover from the disaster. So under this umbrella called security or information security is a lot of stuff. And depending on which view you take, there are a lot of relationships with other elements that are under this umbrella. And in this course, like I said, the focus will be on incident response, but we will be confronted with a lot of bubbles under this umbrella. Remember, when we talk about security, and that's our main topic, we are not only talking about information security. We are also talking about the physical security. The barriers you build around an organization or a building that is tangible, you can touch it, you can hear it. We have to think about personal security. Remember safety. No harm to people. We have to think about operation security, our daily business operations. We have to talk about and think about our communication security. We are all using computers connected to other computers by a network. So data communication, telecommunication is essential in today's world. And when we use this type of communication, of course, network security is also very important. So security, six areas. And not only area four, information security. And you'll come across during incident response all these six areas. When we talk about security, what are the players? What are the actors? Well, the main actor are the people who own the assets. Most of the time, that's the C-level. The CEO, the CIO, the CFO, the CTO, all the chief whatever officers, they own the assets. And they can delegate a part of their responsibility to managers. Sometimes the owners don't want to buy something. They want IT people to develop applications. Well, then you have to be aware that you have secure software development. How to manage that, you will learn as a security student in course number four that will start tomorrow morning, software security. And then, after an application has been developed, it's going live, and then you have the administrators monitoring the network, monitoring the total IT infrastructure where your software or your applications are part of. And it's all meant for our users, the people doing their daily jobs, and to perform their tasks. They need information they get out of their applications that come from our IT infrastructure. And sometimes, once in a while, the owner wants to know, where do we stand? How good are we? Can we do some things better? And then they hire an auditor. They can do an IT audit. They can do a compliance audit. They can do a security audit. They can do whatever audit. And they simply put a thermometer into the organization and the area they have to audit, and they give a signal, it's okay. Here it's not okay, you have to perform or introduce some extra countermeasures. And then it's the owner that has to decide whether or not he listens to what the auditor found. Where are you going to be during incident response? Well, partly you are going to be like an auditor. You are going to try to find out how the incident response management is done in a certain organization. And sometimes it's like stepping into the shoes of a user to find out what is good and what is not good. Information security, why are we doing it? Why do we need it? What are the reasons to involve in security? Okay, although we all are IT people, we are only serving. We are serving with everything that we do, everything that we make, everything that we invent, the business. Business needs first. If there is no business, no IT. So the business and the continuity of the business is numero uno, and then the people that perform the business, and then the processes that people perform to get the business done, and finally the technology or the IT infrastructure and their components. So security in general, and of course because it's one area, information security also, four important functions: to protect, to enable, look at the data, and safeguard. So it's about protection, safeguarding. That's the main thing that we try to achieve with security and information security. But what if the business goes okay? Technology will go fine. Everything we want to achieve is that the business can hold up its position with its competitors, that the business has enough cash to buy things or to do business, that it's profitable, that there are more on the income side than at the output side. We want to have continuity of our services, otherwise our customers go to our competitor. We want to comply a lot of laws, a lot of regulations, and if you don't comply as an organization, you get fined, sometimes you get sued, that costs money. So you want to avoid that you're not compliant with regulations. And of course, you want to keep up your good work, your good job, and your good reputation as a business. And when shit happens, and it does, we only don't know when or how. It can be this afternoon, can be tomorrow, can be next week, next month, next year. But Murphy will do his job. Shit happens, incidents do come up, and then it's the way how we as an organization react by incident response, if we can keep up these elements. Excuse me. That's about security. That's about information security. The second fundamental part is risks. I told you already that we want to minimize the business risks. You can't put risk at zero. It's impossible. The moment you start living, you start having risks until you die. That's for human beings, but it's also for organizations. Risks. Why care about risks? Well, if you start up a new company or a new organization, you start with a mission. You want to achieve something. Be the best in, or make the most beautiful application, whatever. To accomplish this mission, you need assets. Assets you have to buy. They cost money. And we have four categories of assets. Information is one of the four. And we are only going to take into account the critical assets, those assets that are absolutely necessary for our mission. So we don't look into the small, minor assets like paper clips. one or more of our critical assets, for example, a production line or an aircraft, if that is lost due to incidents, then we have a major problem. So we want to prevent the loss of one of more or more of our critical assets so that we can continue working according our mission. Then you have to know some sort of definitions. What is risk? Risk assets, threats, measures for protection. Aha. So there is only a risk when you have an asset, when you have a threat, and hopefully you can minimize the threat by putting some kind of measure between the threat and the asset so that it's protected. What assets do we need to protect? The critical ones. Those assets that are absolutely necessary for our mission. If you don't have them or lose them, business is down, is out. Okay, assets and threats. Aha. How are those assets threatened? Threat events. Mm-hmm. If a threat event occurs, we have to decide, is it a near miss, a close call, or is it an incident or an accident? If it's a near miss or a close call, nothing bad happened. But if the threat event seems to be an incident or an accident, then something bad has happened. And that's the first thing you do when you are confronted with a threat event, when you talk about incident response. Is it an incident or is it not an incident? No incident, okay. Then we take, of course, some steps, but minimal steps. And if it's an incident, okay. Now we have to decide what type of incident is it. Is it a minor incident? High incident. Okay. Is it a catastrophe? Is it a disaster? Then we have to decide, do we go the way of the standard incident handling or do we have to alert business continuity and disaster recovery? So that's all a decision you have to make when we talk about incident response, but that will come up in the upcoming lectures. What can we do to counter those threats? Well, first you have to know where do we stand today, and then if we find some gaps, what can we put in place as safeguards or measures to plug the holes? Before I go on with the risks, I look at my watch and I see that we need a break. Or you need a break, I think. Yes. It's about... I arranged with my sec students last quarter. Sec, not the X. No. The dirty mind. That about 45 minutes, then you're full, and then we have to have a short break. So, I'll take a short break, 10 minutes, because when I'm a little further on in the lecture, you get a longer break because you have to do something in that break that will be a half an hour. So now we have a 10 minutes break and then we continue. So be aware that 45, we start again. Yeah. Okay, 2:45. Please, you obviously have used your cell phone during the break. Please check if the sound is off. So what we have seen until now is assets. We need to protect them. Why? Because assets have vulnerabilities, and there are in the world sources of threat events that want to attack our assets, and we have to take countermeasures to prevent those threat events to become serious incidents, and therefore we need to investigate the current state. Well, we are not going to investigate the current state because that has everything to do with risk management. And that was the topic of course number one, risk assessment. Here you see two important standards that we use when we talk about information security. The 27001, the information security management system, blah, 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 to plan, do, check and act a complete set of policies, procedures, whatever, to implement information security. And the most down-to-earth part is the practical part, the 27002. We tackled risk management in course one. We are now looking into the highlights that come out of a risk assessment, and then we step over to another part of this standard, being section 13 and 14. Okay, if you perform a risk assessment, you are evaluating the current state of your information security situation or your security according to the assets you have. Then you have to go all the way, mainly this blue part being to identify risk, to analyze risk, to evaluate risk, and then come up with a set of possible countermeasures, and then management has to treat the found risks. It's not part of you as IT people doing a risk assessment. So what we did is we used a risk model, a clear and loud overview of all the important components when you talk about risk. We have, here we have our owners, at the right hand side our assets, at the left hand side our threat agents that perform threat events. But to simplify this correlated model, you can subdivide it into seven elements, seven components. So you can look into every element step by step. Look into the owners, the assets, the threat agents, then into the threats, the vulnerabilities, the risk and the countermeasures. What we did, and it will be helpful for the FIS students to know what has been done in the course before. It's through an open door. So that you can get help, assistance from the security students in your team when something comes up that has to do with one or more of the elements of risk assessment. Okay, when we talk about owners, not coming in, okay. When we talk about owners, the owner is positioned into the company, in the organization itself. And an organization is embedded in its environment. So we have to know where the organization starts and where the organization stops. We need to know where the boundaries are. Because everything outside of the boundaries of an organization is called the environment. And then you have a nearby, a further away, and a far, far away environment. So you have to look into an organization, and when you do that, you look into the internal context. How is the organization built up, subdivided? And the relations between the environment and the organization itself is called the external context. We talked about information as being one of four major assets. There are four categories of assets. We need to know and we need to protect them. The first one is people. Remember, safety first, people first. The second asset is property, your buildings, your offices, or your equipment, your vehicles, whatever. The third major asset is information, mainly proprietary information, so the information that is specifically owned by an organization, that can be recipes, that can be strategic plans, that can be financial overviews, whatever. And the fourth, the most intangible asset is reputation, the business reputation. The better your reputation is, the more likely it is that customers will buy something from you, either a good or a service, and that they will continue a relationship with you as an organization. So these four assets are the ones that we are looking into when we are talking about shit. Because a threat event, there's some bad guy or girl being a threat agent that wants to take one or more of your assets. But remember, there are not only bad guys and girls. So we don't should make the mistake that a threat event only comes from criminals. No, we have to take into account that a threat event can also have natural causes or semi-natural causes, and then we call it a hazard. Think like a lightning or a tsunami or a fire or that kind of what's commonly called acts of God, who that may be. So you have people, malicious related events, criminal events, being threat events, but you also have hazardous events that are not planned. It can be by mistake or an error. Okay, our threat agents, when we look into the criminal side of the threats, we can subdivide it into the violent ones. They use weapons when they perform a threat attack, and they most of the times they will do harm to people as an asset next to the other assets they are interested in. The petty criminals, well, they are only after money, and sometimes somebody gets hurt, but that's not part of the plan. The pickpocketers, or the ones that break into cars, or ruin your stuff. The economic criminals after your money. Well, where is your money? That depends. Most of the money is either in property or in information. And then you have activists, from small individuals until internationally organized groups. They want to disturb your business. The kind of attacks they perform, it's always one or more of the attacks against people or property or information or they use different methods to perform an attack on people or property or information. A direct attack on your business reputation is not common. Most of the time it's another type of attack on people, property or information that will result in a diminishing effect on your reputation. Okay, the main part is that when we look into the relationships, you have threat agents that perform threats called threat attacks, and an asset has one or more vulnerabilities. And there, where an asset has a vulnerability, there is a possibility for a threat agent to perform a threat event just at the point where the vulnerability is. So what we want to do in case of security, build something in between so that a threat agent can't perform a threat event on a specific vulnerability of one of your assets. And that's what we call a countermeasure or a safeguard. So, short sum up the elements of risk. We deal with assets and vulnerabilities. Every asset always has vulnerabilities, but you can diminish the possibility to make use of that vulnerability. And the threat, that's what we have to deal with, because the threat is by either a threat attacker or a hazard capable of exploiting the specific vulnerabilities of a specific asset. And so we have a potential harm. And we don't want potential harms in case of security. A threat is an event that has potential consequences. When an event is happening, remember what I said, if there are no consequences, we don't have an incident, we only have a near miss, a near hit, or a close call. It's not nice, but you don't have to go through all the parts of incident response. If a threat as an event has a potential consequence, one or more, yes, then we have an incident. Or an accident, depending on what line of business you're in. And a threat attack is a threat that is carried out, a threat action. So that's a threat agent really doing bad stuff against one or more of your assets. And then you have either it has potential consequences, yes, it has consequences, then you have a violation of your security and you don't want that, that's undesirable. So you have to face the threat consequences. And depending on what kind of threat event is happening, you have different threat consequences. And the main consequences are loss. Okay, remember that The entity that we call a threat agent, that is performing a threat event or an attack, has many names. It's an attacker, adversary, threat agent, criminal, whatever you want to call this entity. I most of the time call it a threat agent, but it's the same as attacker. Okay. What I said, if there are negative consequences, we have an undesirable security result, that means loss. And then we have to look into what kind of loss are we faced with. Loss of people? Oops. By all means, we have to prevent loss of people, because safety first. Then we have loss of property, loss of information, proprietary information, and loss of business reputation. It can be 1 out of 4, it can be 2 out of 4, 3 out of 4, of all 4, depending on the incident. And when we look closely into mainly information security, you see the CIA coming up again. If an asset becomes leaky, water is going through the holes, then we have a loss of confidentiality. Our confidence is streaming out, flowing away. An asset can be corrupted, then it's no longer that what we meant it to be. So the integrity of the asset is lost. That can be data integrity loss or system integrity loss. And if you can't use the asset anymore, nevermore, or for a short time, not usable or unavailable, then we have a loss of availability. You can't reach your data, or you can't turn on your system. So loss is the ultimate consequence of a security threat event, and we want to prevent it from happening. That means that after you have done a risk assessment and you know where you are, looking at the current state of your situation, you have to make arrangements that when a threat event is happening, you as soon as possible know, does it have consequences or are there no consequences? Or is it a near miss or is it a real incident or accident? That is when we go into section 13 and 14 of the 27002. 13 is incident management. All these things we are going to work our way through during this course. And when it's a catastrophe, then we have to look into disaster recovery. That's part of business continuity with those two elements. Okay. How are you going until now? Is it clear? Is it understandable, especially the FIS students, because we are new for each other? Is the pace okay? Too fast? Too slow?
Maybe a bit slow.
I can speed up?
Yeah.
Okay. Now, sometimes I'll be asking these questions, so please be open to give me an answer. I'm here to help you. You have to get used to me, and I have to get used to you. So if you want to, I put on an extra gear. Threat events. I'm going to give you an example. We know we have an organization that's in a certain state, the current state. It's all often called the IST situation. It's difficult to combine the German pronunciation with the English, but it's the IST. The future situation, or the situation you want to create, is called the ZEIL. And then we have the way we have to define from how we are here today and how we want to be tomorrow. Well, if you know our current situation, then you have to be aware that Murphy is always there. You don't know exactly when he's going to hit you, but he will. So shit happens, security incidents will happen. You have to be aware where are the risks so that you can take proper countermeasures. And remember that a human being is always the weakest link in the chain of countermeasures. We want, for the new situation, reducing the risk, so plugging the holes being vulnerabilities, and minimize the effects, so the consequences of an incident when happening, minimizing the loss of our assets. How to get there? Well, you can do a marvelous job in performing a risk assessment with a beautiful schedule of where the risks are, what countermeasures should be taken, in what order, what it will cost, and what you will gain. But there's one problem. It has to do with the human. It's management, the C-level, that has to do the risk treatment. So if the management doesn't provide the organization with the proper countermeasures defined, you still have the problem. Then the water is still leaking out. So one way to make management aware that they should act is raise their consciousness. Make them aware that your organization is under siege, that you need to do something, otherwise you're no longer in business. By raising consciousness, you can use awareness campaigns. Awareness campaigns can use three elements: confronting, storytelling, and investigating. You're going to do all three during incident response. And after raising consciousness so that they are more aware, you hope the management is ready enough to take the measures you need. Okay. Normally, you start alphabetically with the A, then the B, then the C. So normally an organization starts, when we talk about security, by making policies. Bore, 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 bore. If that's not enough, and most of the times it's not enough, because policies, if they are made, they are not followed, then some outside entity comes in and says, I want to check if you comply by the regulations. Well, that's nasty, because if you don't comply, I told you, you'll get fined or sued or whatever. Then it's enforced from the outside world on your organization. And then when you make policies that are not used, the auditors say you're doing something wrong, you have to enforce your policies upon the organization, you have to finally educate everybody in the organization to raise the awareness to be safe and secure. You can also do it the other way around, not ABC, but simply raising awareness by confrontation, storytelling, and investigating. For example, confrontation. Confrontation is what you are going to do in your first assignment. I'll give you an example of storytelling. When you look at the slides of the original slides of the Stalling's book, you find these pictures. The security students know them already. So I took out of the pictures a couple of ones to illustrate how you can tell a story. So when you have a story, you always start with the context. Once upon a time, a couple of centuries ago, there was a kingdom, and in the kingdom there was a castle, and the castle was owned by the king. Our king had a lot of assets, mainly money that he took off the poor farmers and the citizens, and he kept all the money in the basement of the castle behind closed doors. And because he knew there were a lot of bad guys looking for his gold, he knew that where he stored the asset was a place with a lot of vulnerabilities. So what he did, he took some countermeasures, he put the money into a treasure trove with a lot of locks and keys. And he thought he was safe. But, as you know, because the basement was a vulnerability, that's the location where a threat event could happen. And of course, outside the castle, there are a lot of threat agents. So a couple of those threat agents grouped together. Here you see the castle, and somehow they got hold of the key of the treasure trove and they attacked the castle. But the king was wise. He not only put all the gold in the treasure trove, he had knights, his own knights, as an extra countermeasure that could act upon a threat attack to counter the threat agent. But the threat agents were quite a lot stronger and in greater number than the defending knights, so they managed to get into the castle. Because they had the key, they went to the basement and they stole the money, gold, away. Shit! What he did, and what you normally do, is the king ordered the wizard to do an investigation. How was it possible to steal all this gold, and how was it possible that his own knights weren't able to counter the attackers? Well, our wizard made a study, he looked into the threat incident, and he wrote everything that he found in a factual representation of what happened and how it happened. And finally, he proclaimed his findings to the king. And what the wizard, as an investigator, came up with was not only what had happened and how it happened, but how to prevent a next time the same kind of attack. So, apart from those threat agents, those knights, with those black knights as defenders, he had discovered that there were more possible threat agents than only from bad knights. Viruses, dragons, hazards. The king hadn't thought about hazards. So after his investigation, the wizard came up with a solution that for all categories of threat events, there should be countermeasures put into place. And the king was very happy when he heard the results of the investigation of the wizard. And he happily lived ever after. So this is in a short form, a kind of confrontation. I used the pictures and the time setting of the pictures of Stallings to put a story together. But if you are able to put a story together for a specific organization and a specific management, you can make them aware that they are, well, kind of blinded, half-sighted. They only think about the most obvious, namely knights attacking the castle. But there are so many more forms of possible threat events and threat agents that if you don't take them into account, you have a problem. Okay. Summary. Until now, I hope you have a bit of understanding of the risk model with the three main questions: what assets do owners need to protect? How are those assets threatened, and what can owners do to counter those threats? That you have a picture of how a risk assessment is built up. You need to identify your assets for classes or categories. What vulnerabilities are there? You have to know something about threats, not only criminals but also hazards. You have to look in all the categories of threat agents, most of the time if they are criminal four. What security risks are there, and are they low, moderate, or high? Safeguards or countermeasures are needed, and recommendations to management how to mitigate, minimize the risk you assess. How to achieve security and the importance of security awareness. But now we're going to the assignments. This is only the fundamentals. You have enough information now to start the assignments on incident response. Well, this is a beautiful picture I found. This is what you are going to be confronted with. And you have to go into defend yourself against this evil creature. Okay, I'm going to talk you through two things: the attitude you need for incident response, or mainly the attitude you need for performing the assignments, and the format we will be using. Maybe you heard of Sun Tzu. Most of the time, when I'm looking well, I see three ladies in this room. Security, IT security, is a male business. Because it's male-oriented, they usually take into mind typical masculine metaphors, like war. Well, one of the best-selling books for management, C-levels, which are mainly male, is Sun Tzu, The Art of War. Somebody read it? I see one hand coming up. Well, the main thought in the book of Sun Tzu, The Art of War, are these three thoughts. I start with the bottom line. If you know neither the enemy nor yourself, you will succumb in every battle. So, plainly said, if you don't know who your enemy is, and you don't know the strengths and the weaknesses of yourself, every battle that you are fighting, or every battle you have to fight in, you will lose. But, second rule, if you know yourself, but not the enemy, then it's a gamble. Every victory that you gain will on the other side have a loss, a suffer. The top line: if you know the enemy and you know yourself, you need not fear the result of 100 battles. Well, Sun Tzu was a general in the Chinese army a couple of centuries ago, and because he had to do a lot of war, he studied the enemy, he studied the capabilities of his own armies, and he came to the conclusion that they lost quite a lot of battles because they weren't aware of who the enemy was, the strength of the enemy, the means of attack of the enemy, and he didn't know the strength and the capabilities of his own armies. So he started to, well, introduce again espionage. He sent officers from his own army into the field to spy on the enemy, to see how big is the army of the enemy. How are they training? What weapons do they use? What maneuvers do they make? And his officers came back with all this information, and he prepared himself for a battle against that enemy. That was a good start, but it was not enough. The top line, of course, the spies went to all the foreign enemies and the foreign armies. But with the information they came back, he trained his own armies exactly to perform the right countermeasures when it came to battle. And not one, not two, not 50, no. He didn't fear the result of 100 battles, because his armies were trained to counter in the right way the foreign armies. So that is the main stuff that you can take out of Sun Tzu, The Art of War. Know yourself, but mainly know the enemy. And that is what your first assignment will be. Learn to know the enemy. But if you don't know who your enemy is and what he can do, then you are not able to prepare yourself for the war with your enemy. So that will be your attitude. Start with nothing. Start with learning to think like your enemy, and then start not only to learning to think as your enemy, but to act accordingly so that you conquer your enemy. Okay. You're going to step into the shoes of an attacker, a threat agent, an enemy, or whatever, so that you better understand how your threat agent, your enemy, operates. You can't perform incident response in a proper way if you're not able to think how your opponent might attack you. So this wizard, he imagined that if he was a knight or virus or a dragon or fire, what would be the most convenient part of the castle to plan an attack on? There are two rules of thumb you have to follow, otherwise you don't get a good result. 6 P's and 6 T's. Proper prior planning prevents poor performance. So before you really can act your threat event, perform, you have to do a planning. And this planning you have to do before you launch your attack. That's prior. And it has to be a good, decent planning. Proper. If you don't plan at all and simply whoppa attack the castle, you have poor performance. You'll be knocked down by the guards. If you are sneaky, and you are, because you are going to step into the shoes of an attacker, you need to think about the 6 T's. Every attacker, every threat agent thinks about the target. What asset are we after? Time. When is the most convenient time to launch the attack? That won't have to be today or tomorrow. That can be next month or maybe in a long weekend with a holiday. If you encounter agents of the organization, the defending knights, you need to have a talk ready. You have to talk yourself out of the situation. Or you have to use your talk, your words, to, talk yourself in. You tools? What tools do you need, for example, to break in a castle? You need tactics. Depending on the situation, are you going to let yourself drop down on the roof of the castle? Are you going to wait until the bridge is lowered down so that you can cross the bridge? Or are you sneaky and waiting until the night and then you are swimming through the canal around the castle to enter it through the back door? Assuming there are no crocodiles or piranhas in the water around the castle. You need to have a tail. So you have to think about the story that has to have certain stages. First I want to do this, then I want to do that, then I want to do that, and finally I have to do this. So from the beginning, during the act, and after finishing the act, you have to stage your story. So that you exactly know what person from my team has to do what at what moment with what tools and how are we going to do it. Anybody seen the movie The Bank Job?
Yeah.
Yes. The guys that rented a retail store next to a bank in London dug a tunnel from the store into the vault of the bank during a long weekend, robbed the complete vaults of the banks and got out. Well, afterwards it went wrong as usually because the team was not so coherent as they thought. Okay, that should be your attitude. Think like an attacker. Step into his shoes, literally and figuratively. That's what we call ethical hacking. Remember, it's between quotes. So you're not going to really do a hack. You're thinking like a hacker, and you do it in an ethical way. Meaning, you do an operation, but you got the permission to do the operation. You have some knowledge of the organization you are going to attack. You have that information from this organization because the organization hired you to test the security. And it's your job to find weaknesses in the security system. And if you found any weaknesses, well, then it's called a vulnerability, and every vulnerability can be exploited. Simple question is, how? For you to find an answer. Your objectives. You're going to duplicate the intent and the actions of a real threat agent, but without causing harm. So you can't damage people, you can't damage property, you can't damage information, and you can't damage reputation. No harm allowed. If you harm yourself, you're stupid. What you are going to do is called penetration testing. When you conduct a penetration test, the ultimate goal is to determine what can a threat agent find out about a system, an information system, a service or data, whatever. To determine not only what a threat agent can find out, but also whether a threat agent can gain access to your system, and not only gain access, but also maintain access. Maybe the threat agent has a plan to use the gained entrance at a later time. Not only what a threat agent can find out, whether he or she can gain and maintain access, but also whether the threat agent's tracks can be successfully covered without being detected. Haha. When the job is done, he has to leave the premises, when possible, without leaving any traces. Well, that's nearly impossible, but to minimize the traces that are left behind. That's your job. But it's ethical hacking, so you need to be aware that there are some moral ethical imperatives that you need to take into consideration. These eight are almost standard in every code of ethics. Contribute to society and human well-being. The experiences you go through will be of help for organizations and for the next generation. Avoid harm to others. Safety first. Be honest and trustworthy. Certainly in your team. So keep your team members aware of what you think, what you want to plan, so that you don't do any stupid things that your team members could have corrected if they knew you were planning it. And be fair and take action not to discriminate. So the way you are performing your job should be straightforward. No sneaky things unless allowed. Think about the proprietary information. Don't steal, use or misuse those things. Think about the privacy and be confidential. Okay. Here you see chapter 19, the code of ethics. There are only refinements of what I just told you to give you an idea about what rules you have to comply with when you do ethical hacking. Okay, now the format. We're doing it in the standard format, but before I go to the format and the real assignment, you have a break, half an hour. So at 4 o'clock sharp, we start again. And in the meantime, you not only take coffee, tea, bread, cigarettes, whatever you need, but you have to form teams. I need teams. Each team should have 6 members. And it should be a mixture of security students and forensic intelligence and security students. So I want 6 students and 5 students. Before you start talking, guys. I put out the camera for the moment.